Well, good morning. How did you do with 1 hour fewer? I know, yeah. Well, good for you for showing up. Even with 1 hour less of sleep, here we are. It's amazing. Maybe a miracle. Welcome to Elkhi United Church of Christ on this fourth Sunday of the season of Lent. Lent is this great time we get every year in the season of the church to slow down and reflect and turn inward. It's time to wonder, time to listen. And our theme this year is Wandering Hearts. We're looking for ourselves in the stepping stones of Peter's journey. As we wander, we tune our hearts to sing God's grace. May we rest in streams of mercy that never cease. Like many of us, Peter has a wandering heart. Maybe Peter didn't do that well on a 1 hour fewer of sleep either. His journey is not polished or linear or perfect, but he's always tethered to the love of God, and so are we. Let us breathe in the peace of God, the light of love. We acknowledge that we are on the unceded traditional land of the Coast Salish people, including the Duwamish and the Suquamish people, past and present. We honor with gratitude the land itself and the wisdom of these tribes. Wherever you are on your spiritual journey, you have a place here today at Elkhi UCC.
The scripture this morning is Matthew 16, verses 21 to 28. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you."
But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life?"
For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. So ends the reading.
Get behind me, Satan. Jesus is not playing around. These are some powerful words to bring Peter back to what is important. Jesus said, "You are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Peter wandered into the territory of fear and misunderstanding. We do too. Jesus says, come back to me. I wonder what brings you back to God when you wander. Sometimes words bring us back. Born in 1735, Robert Robinson was a lover of languages from the age of six, a student of Latin and Greek. Upon the death of his father, his mother could no longer afford for him to continue his studies, and she sent him from Suffolk, England, to London at the age of 14 to be apprenticed to a barber. His mom was the spiritual one. Robert was not so interested in religion. He and his friends were always up to some kind of trouble. They had a habit of getting a local fortune teller drunk and laughing about her predictions. And they heard about a famous preacher, Reverend George Whitefield, and decided, let's go and heckle him. That became a turning point for Robert, because even though he went to poke fun at the local Methodists, the words he heard preached about the wrath to come went straight to his heart and broke him open. He wrestled with those words for nearly 3 years and called it tasting the pains of renewal. At the age of 20, he became a preacher himself. And at the age of 22, when preparing a sermon, he penned the great hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. But his wandering continued. His theology evolved over time, and he took a lot of heat when he questioned the divinity of Christ. His faith wasn't a straight line. He wrestled and wondered. He didn't always feel tethered to the love of God. I imagine that it was a lonely road. 30 years after writing this great hymn, he was riding on a stagecoach through the English countryside, and there was a young woman who was nearby singing to pass the time. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for sounds of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it. Mount of God's unchanging love. After she finished singing to herself, the woman asked Robert, have you heard that song? And he said, I am the unhappy man who composed that hymn many years ago. And I would give 1,000 worlds if I had them, if I could feel now as I felt then. His own words were returned to him in a time when he most needed to hear them. The words, the music, brought him back. Even when we don't feel it or sense it, we are always tethered to the love of God. We won't lose our way or lose ourselves. We can always find God back, and we will always be found. Words or music can bring us back. Like Robert Robinson hearing his own song, there might be words that have said to you, or a song that is meaningful to you, or a poem recited that when you hear it again, it brings you back to the divine. It brings you back to God's heart. It brings you back to you. It makes you feel more alive and reminds you of what is important. Maybe you've read something once that you've never forgotten, Perhaps someone you greatly respected affirmed something in you or reminded you of a calling. Words can work on us through the years. Teachers of contemplation and centering prayer suggest choosing one centering word to help us focus on God. That single word can call us back when our mind wanders. The word I chose many years ago when first learning centering prayer was the word open. I've never felt the need to change the word. It always calls me back. Sometimes it's not a word or a song, but a body posture that brings us back to God. An embodiment of being fixed upon God's love. A posture of trust. The poem in the Wandering Heart devotional for this week is called Open Hands. This is a poem by Reverend Sarah Speed. I'll read it for you now. We're born with the ability to wrap our fingers around another, to hold tight to what we know. Maybe that's where the instinct comes from. This clinging, this sinking, this holding on. Maybe that's why Peter cries, never, when Jesus must leave. From the very beginning, we've known how to hold tight. So I pray, open up my hands, uncurl my fingers one by one, loosen the grip that I hold unyielding. Remind me that birds must fly and children must grow and leaves must fall. And even though we are born with the ability to hold tight, we can learn how to love with open hand. Simply opening our hands can bring us back to God. It's a gesture of letting go, of knowing that we are not in control. It's an embodiment of trust. We can learn how to love with open hands, or on our knees, or hands on our hearts, or sprawled out lying on our backs, or reaching up as high as we can. There is no one way to embody being brought back to the heart of God. Sometimes it isn't a word or a song or a posture that brings us back to God. Sometimes it's an object, something that beckons us to remember. The original second verse of Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing begins with, here I raise my Ebenezer. Well, what in the world is that? I mean, I always think Ebenezer Scrooge, yeah. Well, the term Ebenezer is of Hebrew origin, and it means stone of help. It comes from the Bible, where the prophet Samuel sets up a stone to commemorate God's help to the Israelites. So in the hymn, raising the Ebenezer is an act of setting up a memorial or a marker to acknowledge and praise God's faithfulness and assistance in the past. Praise the Mount. It's referring to this Ebenezer, the stone of help, God's unchanging love. This makes me think of a cairn, a pile of stones that people set up to mark a sacred space. This is nothing new. People have been setting these up since ancient times. Stones marking the path on a journey to mark the place, to signal a promise, a hope, to proclaim this ground is holy. God is here. Sacred objects can help us to set our mind on divine things. Maybe for you it's a pile of stones, or a special candle, or beautiful work of art. We need reminders of the sacred because human things are what we know. Like Peter, we cleave to the present, to the comfortable, to the familiar. I think we can relate to Peter's fear. He doesn't want things to change. He doesn't want his friend to die. Change is hard, especially when death is involved. But we are called to follow Jesus right out of our comfort zone. And we can't do this on our own. We can only do it by the grace of God. I wonder what helps you fix upon God's unchanging love. Is it a word or phrase, a song, lyric, or tune? Maybe it's a posture, the invitation of embodiment. Maybe it's an object that calls you back. Praise the mount. I'm fixed upon it. Mount of God's unchanging love. Whatever calls you back, focus on that. Let it resound in you. God is there.
Good morning, everyone. In celebration of Women's History Month, I wanted to pick someone whose music has been very inspiring to me for a very long time. And this is Aretha Franklin. This is an arrangement of Bridge Over Troubled Water, which was written by Paul Simon, and it was one of Aretha's favorite songs to sing. And this is her arrangement of it. She was a wonderful piano player as well as a singer. I encourage you all to sing along with me, if you know the words. When you're weary, yes, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I will dry them all. I'm on your side when time can rough and friends just can't be found, like a bridge over troubled water, I will lay. Thank you. Thanks for singing, everyone.